In probability theory, the central limit theorem states that, given certain conditions, the arithmetic mean of a sufficiently large number of iterates of independent random variables, each with a well-defined expected value and well-defined variance, will be approximately normally distributed, regardless of the underlying distribution. To illustrate what this means, suppose that a sample is obtained containing a large number of observations, each observation being randomly generated in a way that does not depend on the values of the other observations, and that the arithmetic average of the observed values is computed. If this procedure is performed many times, the central limit theorem says that the computed values of the average will be distributed according to the normal distribution. A simple example of this is that if one flips a coin many times, the probability of getting a given number of heads should follow a normal curve, with mean equal to half the total number of flips. The central limit theorem has a number of variants. In its common form, the random variables must be identically distributed. Invariance, convergence of the mean to the normal distribution, also occurs for non-identical distributions or for non-independent observations, given that they comply with certain conditions. In more general usage, a central limit theorem is any of a set of weak convergence theorems in probability theory. They all express the fact that a sum of many independent and identically distributed random variables, or alternatively, random variables with specific types of dependence, will tend to be distributed according to one of a small set of attractor distributions. When the variance of the i.i.d. variables is finite, the attractor distribution is the normal distribution. In contrast, the sum of a number of i.i.d. random variables with power law tail distributions decreasing as x minus alpha minus 1 where 0 less than alpha less than 2 will tend to an alpha stable distribution with stability parameter of alpha as the number of variables grows. Central limit theorems for independent sequences. Classical CLT let x1, xn be a random sample of size n, that is, a sequence of independent and identically distributed random variables drawn from distributions of expected values given by micro and finite variances, given by sigma 2. Suppose we are interested in the sample average of these random variables. By the law of large numbers, the sample averages converge in probability and almost surely to the expected value micro as n infinity. The classical central limit theorem describes the size and the distributional form of the stochastic fluctuations around the deterministic number micro during this convergence. More precisely, it states that as n gets larger, the distribution of the difference between the sample average Sn and its limit micro, when multiplied by the factor square root n, approximates the normal distribution with mean 0 and variance sigma 2. For large enough n, the distribution of Sn is close to the normal distribution with mean micro and variance sigma 2, n. Formally, the theorem can be stated as follows. Lindeberg Eliot VYCLT. Suppose x1, x2 is a sequence of i.i.d. random variables with e she equals micro and var she equals sigma 2 less than infinity. Then as n approaches infinity, the random variables square root n converge in distribution to a normal n. In the case sigma greater than 0, convergence in distribution means that the cumulative distribution functions of square root n converge pointwise to the CDF of the n distribution. For every real number z, where phi is the standard normal CDF evaluated at x, note that the convergence is uniform in Z in the sense that where sup denotes the least upper bound of the set. Lyapunov CLT. The theorem is named after Russian mathematician Alexander Lyapunov. In this variant of the central limit theorem, the random variables she have to be independent, but not necessarily identically distributed. The theorem also requires that random variables, xi, have moments of some order, and that the rate of growth of these moments is limited by the Lyapunov condition given below. Lyapunov CLT. Suppose x1, x2, is a sequence of independent random variables, each with finite expected value mu I and variance sigma 2i. Define if for some delta greater than 0, the Lyapunov's condition is satisfied, then a sum of Sn converges in distribution to a standard normal random variable, as on goes to infinity. In practice, it is usually easiest to check the Lyapunov's condition for delta equals 1. If a sequence of random variables satisfies Lyapunov's condition, then it also satisfies Lindeberg's condition. The converse implication, however, does not hold. Lindeberg's CLT in the same setting and with the same notation as above, the Lyapunov condition can be replaced with the following weaker one. Suppose that for every epsilon greater than 0 where 1 is the indicator function, then the distribution of the standardized sums converges towards the standard normal distribution n. Multidimensional CLT proofs that use characteristic functions can be extended to cases where each individual xi is a random vector and Rk, with mean vector mu equals E and covariance matrix sigma, and these random vectors are independent and identically distributed. Summation of these vectors is being done component-wise. The multidimensional central limit theorem states that when scaled, sums converge to a multivariate normal distribution. Let be the k-vector. The bold in xi means that it is a random vector, not a random variable. Then the sum of the random vectors will be in the averages, and therefore, the multivariate central limit theorem states that where the covariance matrix sigma is equal to generalized theorem, the central limit theorem states that the sum of a number of independent and identically distributed random variables with finite variances will tend to a normal distribution as the number of variables grows. A generalization due to Nedenko and Kolmogorov states that the sum of a number of random variables with a power law tail distributions decreasing as x minus alpha minus 1 where 0 less than alpha less than 2 will tend to a stable distribution as the number of sums grows. If alpha greater than 2, then the sum converges to a stable distribution with stability parameter equal to 2, i.e., a Gaussian distribution. Central limit theorems for dependent processes. CLT under weak dependence. A useful generalization of a sequence of independent, identically distributed random variables is a mixing random process in discrete time. Mixing means, roughly, that random variables temporally far apart from one another are nearly independent. Several kinds of mixing are used in ergodic theory and probability theory. See especially strong mixing defined by alpha 0 where alpha is so-called strong mixing coefficient. A simplified formulation of the central limit theorem under strong mixing is theorem. Suppose that x1, x2, is stationary in alpha mixing with alpha n equals 0 and that e equals 0 and e less than infinity. Denote Sn equals x1 plus xn, then the limit exists, and if sigma 0 then converges in distribution to n, in fact where the series converges absolutely. The assumption sigma 0 cannot be omitted, since the asymptotic normality fails for xn equals yn minus 1 where yn are another stationary sequence. There is a stronger version of the theorem. The assumption e less than infinity is replaced with e less than infinity, and the assumption alpha n equals 0 is replaced with existence of such delta greater than 0 ensures the conclusion. For encyclopedic treatment of limit theorems under mixing conditions, see Martingale difference CLT theorem. Let a Martingale MN satisfy in probability as n tends to infinity. For every epsilon greater than 0, as n tends to infinity, then converges in distribution to n as n infinity. Caution. The restricted expectation E should not be confused with the conditional expectation E equals E, P. Remarks. Proof of classical CLT for a theorem of such fundamental importance to statistics and applied probability. The central limit theorem has a remarkably simple proof using characteristic functions. It is similar to the proof of a law of large numbers. For any random variable, y, with zero mean and a unit variance equals 1, the characteristic function of y is, by Taylor's theorem, where O is, little o notation, for some function of t that goes to zero more rapidly than t2. Letting e be, sigma, the standardized value of xi, it is easy to see that the standardized mean of the observations x1, x2, xn is by simple properties of characteristic functions, the characteristic function of the sum is, so that by the limit of the exponential function n, the characteristic function of zinc is, but this limit is just the characteristic function of a standard normal distribution n, and the central limit theorem follows from the Le acute Vy continuity theorem, which confirms that the convergence of characteristic functions implies convergence in distribution. Convergence to the limit. The central limit theorem gives only an asymptotic distribution as an approximation for a finite number of observations. It provides a reasonable approximation only when close to the peak of the normal distribution. It requires a very large number of observations to stretch into the tails. If the third central moment E3 exists and is finite, then the above convergence is uniform and the speed of convergence is at least on the order of 1/n½. Stein's method can be used not only to prove the central limit theorem, but also to provide bounds on the rates of convergence for selected metrics. The convergence to the normal distribution is monotonic, in the sense that the entropy of zinc increases monotonically to that of the normal distribution. The central limit theorem applies in particular to sums of independent and identically distributed discrete random variables. A sum of discrete random variables is still a discrete random variable, so that we are confronted with a sequence of discrete random variables whose cumulative probability distribution function converges towards a cumulative probability distribution function corresponding to a continuous variable. This means that if we build a histogram of the realizations of the sum of n independent identical discrete variables, the curve that joins the centers of the upper faces of the rectangles forming the histogram converges toward a Gaussian curve as n approaches infinity. This relation is known as de Moivre-Laplace theorem. The binomial distribution article details such an application of the central limit theorem in the simple case of a discrete variable taking only two possible values. Relation to the law of large numbers. The law of large numbers as well as the central limit theorem are partial solutions to a general problem. What is the limiting behavior of Sn as n approaches infinity? In mathematical analysis, asymptotic series are one of the most popular tools employed to approach such questions. Suppose we have an asymptotic expansion of f. Dividing both parts by phi 1 and taking the limit will produce a1, the coefficient of the highest order term in the expansion, which represents the rate at which f changes in its leading term. Informally, one can say, f grows approximately as a1 phi 1. Taking the difference between f and its approximation and then dividing by the next term in the expansion, we arrive at a more refined statement about f. Here one can say that the difference between the function and its approximation grows approximately as a2 phi 2. The idea is that dividing the function by appropriate normalizing functions and looking at the limiting behavior of the result can tell us much about the limiting behavior of the original function itself. Informally, something along these lines is happening when the sum, Sn, of independent identically distributed random variables, x1, xn, is studied in classical probability theory. If each xi has finite mean mu, then by the law of large numbers, Sn, n mu, If in addition each chi has finite variance sigma 2, then by the central limit theorem, where chi is distributed as n, this provides values of the first two constants in the informal expansion in the case where the xis do not have finite mean or variance. Convergence of the shifted and rescaled sum can also occur with different centering and scaling factors, or informally distributions chi which can arise in this way are called stable. Clearly, the normal distribution is stable, but there are also other stable distributions, such as the Cauchy distribution, for which the mean or variance are not defined. The scaling factor Bn may be proportional to nc. For any c 1/2, it may also be multiplied by a slowly varying function of n. The law of the iterated logarithm specifies what is happening in between the law of large numbers and the central limit theorem. Specifically, it says that the normalizing function intermediate in size between n of the law of large numbers and square root n of the central limit theorem provides a non-trivial limiting behavior. Alternative statements of the theorem: density functions. The density of the sum of two or more independent variables is the convolution of their densities. Thus, the central limit theorem can be interpreted as a statement about the properties of density functions under convolution. The convolution of a number of density functions tends to the normal density as the number of density functions increases without bound. These theorems require stronger hypotheses than the forms of the central limit theorem given above. Theorems of this type are often called local limit theorems. See Petrov for a particular local limit theorem for sums of independent and identically distributed random variables. Characteristic functions. Since the characteristic function of a convolution is the product of the characteristic functions of the densities involved, the central limit theorem has yet another restatement. The product of the characteristic functions of a number of density functions becomes close to the characteristic function of the normal density as the number of density functions increases without bound, under the conditions stated above. However, to state this more precisely, an appropriate scaling factor needs to be applied to the argument of the characteristic function. An equivalent statement can be made about Fourier transforms. Since the characteristic function is essentially a Fourier transform, extensions to the theorem. Products of positive random variables. The logarithm of a product is simply the sum of the logarithms of the factors. Therefore, when the logarithm of a product of random variables that take only positive values approaches a normal distribution, the product itself approaches a log-normal distribution. Many physical quantities are the products of different random factors, so they follow a log-normal distribution, whereas the central limit theorem for sums of random variables requires the condition of finite variance. The corresponding theorem for products requires the corresponding condition that the density function be square integrable.